issue on the African scene. The politics of succession in Africa, the crisis of stability and power. How critical is this?
Police arrested 4 people for the violence in Johannesburg, while 8 others were arrested.
The relationship between class, race, and ethnicity is the crux in understanding any complex, stratified, plural society. And so the question is it the lack of understanding of this complex mix that has continued to cause conflict among African nations, fueled by ethnic and racial conflict amongst them? These are the questions that we are posed with on today's edition of The Agenda. My name is Henry Williams. Join us for all the facts and the sides after this break.
From Lagos
to London, from Johannesburg,
for several years our economy,
to the United States,
identifying houses of worship.
We have all the world covered for you, no matter where you are.
Love with News is at the heart of it all.
Experience.
We bring you our perspectives of stories behind the story.
The signs given to us for the entry of these things are before us.
Join us.
Join us.
Join us on this station.
Poverty, strife, conflict, and corruption. These are common narratives on the continent. But this is another side untold, the side of wealth, riches, and the continent with most blessed resources. Until you change a man's thinking, you cannot change his life. Africa's story has been written by others. We need to own our challenges and solutions and write our stories. Only Africans can build Africa. My name is Henry Williams. Join me on The Agenda on Love War Plus. Now, I want to say welcome to the show. It's The Agenda, talking Africa and African issues. Virtually every African conflict has some ethno, racial, or regional dimension to it. Even those conflicts that may appear to be free of ethnic, racial concerns involve factions and alliances built around ethnic loyalties. So how do we wean ourselves from these shackles that bind us from getting Africa to work together in one focus? These are the issues we'll be talking about on today's edition of The Agenda. My name is Henry Williams, and I want to tell you that you can join us and watch us on the go when you log on to our website at www.loveworldplus.tv or hook up by downloading our apps from any of the online stores, and it's Love War Plus. Well, right here with me, I have my guest, Adeni Ikunu, who joins me on The Agenda. Thank you very much, Ni. It's great having you once more on The Agenda.
As a thank you again for bringing me back here. Thank you.
Yes, and so today's discourse actually provides some hope that we can find and probably chart a new course in our psyche as Africans and arrive at a place that will, help Africa move on a positive trajectory.
Yes, indeed it is possible. There's a common parlance where I come from, in the Southwest, that the insect that actually eats the leaves is found in the leaves.
Wow.
Then the solution to a problem is oftentimes even in the problem. We really need to understand that Africa, due to black in the diaspora, have come of age to begin to look inwards, because any solution to any problem begins from doing a self-assessment of you before you look at the externalities of your challenges. India,
Before you go into it, okay. That gives us an idea of what we're looking into in today's show. But I also want to let you know that we'll be also joined by another guest online. His name is Jude Idada, screenwriter, actor, and poet, playwright, producer. And he's also an award winner of the prestigious Niger Liquefied Natural Gas NLNG Prize for Literature for his literary works. So on that note, we'll set sail with this report that gives us a better idea and a bigger picture of what we're talking about, and we'll be right back. Don't go away.
African countries recently called on the United Nations Human Rights Council to urgently debate racism and police brutality amid the unrest in the United States and beyond over George Floyd's death. But many hold to the saying that charity begins at home and that racial aggression from an outsider could be tolerated, but coming from a brother and fellow African is unacceptable. Ethnic pygmy populations in Central Africa suffer from racialized discrimination from Bantu people. In 2001, the Ivory Coast government was guilty of fanning ethnic hatred for its own political ends. Racism is still prevalent in South Africa. The end of apartheid might have removed the legal framework allowing institutionalized racism. However, more needs to be done. In Nigeria, the Fulani, the Igbos, and Yoruba tribes discriminate amongst each other sometimes, resulting in ethnic conflicts that have threatened to spiral. In Sudan, black African captives in the civil war were often enslaved with their Arab captors, claiming that Islamic law grants them permission. The list is endless. Analysts hold that history has stripped Africa's people of the dignity of building their nations on their own indigenous values, institutions, and heritage, and the modern African state is the product of Europe, not Africa. To attempt at this late date to return to ancestral identities and resources as basis for building the modern African nation would risk the collapse of many countries. At the same time, to disregard ethnic realities would be to build on loose sand, also a high-risk exercise. Is it possible to consolidate the framework of the modern African state while giving recognition and maximum utility to the component elements of ethnicities, cultures, and aspirations for self-determination? The answer may be in the affirmative. The will, though, seems to be elusive.
All right, race, ethnicity, challenging issues, especially in these climes in Africa. One thing that a saying says is that there is strength in diversity.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, we've not been able to harness that saying into the realities we have on the African scene. Nii, what are your thoughts on this issue?
Well, I have to say that there was a substitution of identities, and many African countries appear to have forgotten that, you know, imposed substitution of the identities must be the historicity well understood for them to get back on track as it concerns, you know, the strength of the African race one more time. If you look at some point, I like to talk about China. China, at some point, was colonized by Britain, by Germany. At some point, China was completely dominated by Japan. But if you check China, one of the things that it has been able to do is it has not allowed its language to be lost in the very negatives that are associated with colonial experiences. I've talked about Britain, I've talked about Germany, and I've talked about Japan. In fact, Japan's hold on China was brutal. That further led to the poverty of China in the 40s, 50s. And China has Mao Zedong to thank for that nationalistic revival of the Chinese people, such that their education and virtually everything that has to do with China as a country, their learning, their language, their songs, is in China. Let's take a cross to India that got independence in the late 40s. I must say here also, India was colonized by the British people, out of which we have Bangladesh and Pakistan by virtue of being majority Muslim territories.
The British literally conquered two-thirds of the world.
But they did that, and they are also the biggest thieves of gold they didn't have. So they stole in every country they went to, and I just brought it back to Britain. Yes, the British people are the biggest thieves. I'm saying it not because I'm trying to paint them black, but that's what they did. So coming back to the issue, India was equally colonized, but India did something to herself, which is to reserve the language and it made sure that
its culture jealously guarded.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. So India reserved that in its education, in everything. You get your education in India. It doesn't take away the fact that they were colonized by the British or that they can't speak English. But if you come to Africa, for many of the countries in Africa, many of them actually didn't have the capacity to repel that particular high-handedness of the people that colonized them, except, of course, for some places like you have Tanzania, you have like countries like
Ethiopia.
You have like even Senegal repelled at some point because they've had the experience of the Sufi Muslims before the French people came there. So when we talk about the disintegration of Africa in the practical sense of it, such that it appears as if its problem has been so intractable, it is because it has not been able to realize that there are certain things that must happen on a national scale. And I need to say this, if I have the permission before you switch gears, that the consciousness of the black race was further dampened by the collaborators within the entities of Africa. Because when they came, we had fluid boundaries where we could move from one boundary to the other and settle. Africa or our countries were not really made up of people who aligned because you spoke the same language. The humanity was there. Those are pre-colonial facts that can be actually verified. But you see, coming together post-colonial and having been disembarked such that the states were created or the countries were created for administrative and economic reasons.
And language.
Most definitely. And language basis, we've not been able to get back on track. And until we look at these realities and tackle it head on, we might still be wallowing in the mire.
All right. I get a lot of, you know, you dealing with the ethnic challenge in that submission. Let's turn to Jude, who's standing by. Hello, Jude. Are you with us?
Yes, I am. How are you doing?
We can see you right now with your trademark dreads. I can see Jude Idada online. Great to have you join us, Jude. I'm sure you will be acquainted with Adini Kunu, who is here. Adini Kunu is here with me on stage, and he says he's met you quite a few times. Jude, we're talking about a very controversial issue, an issue of huge concern to us right now, which is the issue of race, class, and ethnicity. We've seen what has happened on the international scenes, specifically in the United States, that has spiraled to the Floyd protests, and you know, quite a sad development. But there is another angle to this, that we're just dealing with symptoms here. There's a saying that charity begins at home. How do we deal? We can't deal with the outsider. We are told in a proverb that yes, when you have an enemy from outside, you can easily deal with it. But when the enemy is from within, and we're talking race issues now, how do you deal with race, racism from a fellow brother? You have that, that becomes a very tricky and difficult one.
Yeah, thanks a lot for having me on your show. Adini Kunu, you rightly said, we go way back.
We can't hear you right now. We need we need you to correct that.
Can you hear me?
Okay, good. Now we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Okay.
Yeah, great. So I said thank you for having me on your show.
Yeah.
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
You're fine.
We can hear
thank
you.
Thank you for having me on your show. Myself and Kunu, we go way back. Kunu, I greet.
Yeah.
Contributing to the topic you have raised, I just totally agree with what Adini Kunu had said earlier on. For racism, for me, I also live in Canada, in Toronto, Canada, and I travel a lot in North America. I've lived in different places in Europe and South America, and I have seen what the plight of the people of the darker hue have to face. let us say, when you say, does charity begin at home and all of that, first and foremost, as Kunu said, about colonialism, but we have to also look at what pre-colonialism, what it was for us. And pre-colonialism, we're talking of the days of slave trade, in terms of slave trade in both transatlantic and trans-Saharan. I want people to picture this. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I hope you can. Okay. I want people to picture this. So we have 400 years or thereabouts of a pillaging of the human capital of a continent. When you go out and you go buy stuff, tomatoes, potatoes, whatever, you always pick the choice products of it. You always pick the choice pieces. You don't go and pick the rotten ones and all. So for 400 years, Africa, from the twin ends, trans-Saharan and then trans-Atlantic, were bled of the best of us. The best of us were shipped away. So what was left were the people who either didn't measure up intellectually, physically, or were collaborators or conformists, or, you know, were just people who weren't exceptional. Because we had situations where when there was conquest, you know, the victors took the victims and sold them into slavery. Then we had, obviously, the slave raiders who just came into the hinterland and did their business. That being said, they took us to a foreign land. And for them to conquer us, they first had to wash clean the slate. They had to rob us of our identity, rob us of our language, rob off us of our beliefs, and foist a new belief system on us, a new belief system that said we were inferior. So we were rebuilt, we were re-authored. And this thing, there's apart from the genetic inheritance, there's also the psychological inheritance. So you had the descendants that came after them who continued the brainwash to such an extent that they even believed the brainwash and were propagating it themselves. So we have come to a place now where a healing has to happen. But that healing is deep. It's bone deep. It's bone deep in terms of the challenge that it requires to, first and foremost, because these people are still in the economic framework of North America or Europe, South America, wherever they are. They're in the economic framework. They cannot be wished away. They have come into a place where they cannot come back to Africa. So they have to find a positioning in that place. But to find a positioning in that place means they have to be politically and economically not only emancipated, but empowered. But the powers that be in those societies will not want that because they do not want to upturn the status quo. So you have this undercurrent of the plus and minuses, the positive and negative currents that are swirling under the surface, which we do not see on the outside. These things explode. I, as an African, I come to Canada, I've been in Canada for 20 years now. I do not come with that heritage of the Canadian, or the African Canadian, who has grown up in a system that does everything it can to brainwash him. Even when they teach him history, they never teach him anything about Africa. They only teach him about slavery. They never tell him that he was anything of consequence until after slavery.
How has that impacted the African in Canada, in the West? You know, the curriculum, the educational reorientation or reprogramming, you might put it that way. How has that impacted?
Yeah. For the African, which is someone like me,
yeah,
I am lucky. We are lucky because we have, first and foremost, we come with something from Africa. Even if we were born there and our parents are first generation immigrants, they also they tutor us at home. So we know something about culture. We know something about who we were. We know something about what we are about. But the African Canadian, who is different, so the African Canadian is the descendants of slavery. He is different. His heritage tells him that all he is a descendant of a former slave. That's all he knows. So being a descendant of a former slave, there's always going to be that deficit, self-confidence, self-belief. He's coming from that heritage of discrimination. And when you talk about like the police with George Floyd and everything, the police was, when you go into history, you find out that the police of the United States or North America, they started from being slave patrol. That's what they were. They were slave patrol. They were meant to look for slaves who were running away, enforce the rights of the property owners who are the masters over their chattel, which were the slaves. So that heritage of distrust is centuries old.
Wow.
Where the black man has always looked at the slave patrol, which is the police, as the enforcers of that negative subhuman system, which is now, of course, political and economical in terms of the heritage. So it comes from there, that distrust, that disenfranchisement from the society. That being said, you also have situations of the economic model of the state itself. Who is the black man? When they say all men are created equal, that is in their constitution. Mm. But the thing they did not say was that all these men they are talking about are supposed to be the white men, not the black men. The black men were chattel. When they say you go to heaven, heaven was for the white man, not the black man. I don't know if you know about Amu, the Ghanaian slave who studied up to the level of PhD in the 16th century in Germany. He had to write a treatise where he was arguing that the black man is human and he's how would I say, this is a Christian,
He had to defend his humanity.
Not only his humanity, he had to defend that not only is the black man human, the black man, he has a right to salvation. Mm. And not only does he have a right to salvation, he has a right to enter heaven. People don't understand the heritage of Christianity in that way. Mm. Even in Netherlands, there was another Ghanaian slave. His own was that, his name was Capitaine, I forgot what his first name was. His own argument was that the black man is human, but it is okay for him to be a slave of the white man. Please just baptize him so that he can at least get salvation and go to heaven. These were both well-educated black former, or they were current slaves because they were never free until they came back to Africa. No, Amo came back to Africa, but I don't think Capitaine came. But that was the argument. Oh yes, Capitaine came, sorry. The argument was that we were not human. Heaven was not for us. We were property. So the black intelligentsia, even though they were in servitude, they had to argue to give us rights, the rights that we benefit from now. So when you look at that as an inheritance, I was born in Lagos. Nobody ever told me that. I never needed to fight against that. I never understood it even existed. I'm sure some of your viewers must be hearing this for the first time. Yeah. But imagine people who were born into this kind of system and they had told them day in and day out who you are, what you are not supposed to be, what you are not supposed to do. There was segregation. There was Jim Crow laws. There was so much negativity that has always been holding them back. The fact that the black person has even aspired to the level he has aspired to in North America is a miracle.
Okay, let me come to Ni, based on what Idad has said, does it excuse, can we now look at, do we look at the black man who has actually succumbed to superiority imperialism as his fate and, you know, actually even become, some would use the word traitor to his own fellow, brother or, brother, and actually help to subvert or aid and abet this fraud. Do we have to excuse him and say, based on the premise that, Idada has explained now, that look, there is actually a problem that this person or these people are grappling with, these so-called blacks or Africans who have found their place, as to serve, colonialism?
I think that we have to destroy every boundary of falsity that has actually kept us where we are. And if there's anything blacks in the diaspora should leverage, they should leverage the facts of the African race, and they can latch onto the knowledge of the likes of Judy that who lives over there right now to correct all of the very many negatives that have become white papers that they sell to people. In the first place, let us look at the human color. One of the areas of gross miseducation is to call somebody who is fair-skinned a white. If you hold a paper that is called a white, or you put a white shirt somewhere, and you see somebody who is fair-skinned, how come they call themselves white? It's part of the religious narrative to make sure that those of us that are referred to as Africans or as blacks are those associated with a kind of color that to them represents evil. So anybody who calls them even white perhaps should do a proper research. They are at best called salmons, although we have fishes or some kind of fish called salmon. But the skin color they have is salmon. So rather than call them white, we refer to them as salmon. They can't get angry because your education would have been a loss if you look at the white color and you call somebody who is fair skin white, right. Their color is not white, it's salmon. Having said that, I think people should understand that when slavery was some booming merchandise here, the African collaborators like Madame Tinubu, Efusheto Aniwuras of this world in Ibadan, those people obviously had been conquered. And more or less like the modern economic systems, Jude said something that even right now, they don't want to rock the apple cart, the people who are there. So the economic system of slavery back then happens to have some privileges for those who collaborated with the imperialists.
Exactly.
So what did they do? Don't forget that they were superior to them because they had a gun, they had superior firepower.
So what is the gun this time around?
Well, the gun this time around is that all of the shady businesses and the money you have stolen and kept in our banks, the privileged medical benefits you have where you know that your hospitals are dead, so you quickly run to do your blood pressure check over there, and the fact that you can travel freely with all those things, it will take, in 24 hours, they will just, the West has a way of doing things, they'll just revoke all those things, so you remain here. So the people that you always run from easily because you have stolen from them, you'll be available for them to maim if they have to get you. So for all those people who collaborated, they collaborated because they didn't have an alternative to a great extent. And it has also become the same mouth where they chop, no, they talk.
Yeah.
Make pepper for no enter your throat.
Yeah.
So they collaborated to the extent that they felt they had certain privileges. They believed that it's convenient. But let us also say this, that slavery as a merchandise started with them, but slavery as something that had been there. We've always had servants. Maybe we didn't have slaves. We had those who disobeyed, those who were in prison, but we did not create a market of people incarcerated for errors or crimes against communities pre-colonial times.
Okay.
They made a merchandise of it. So I think that if we're able to let them understand that most people that are actually castigated, they are ancestors as having collaborated in selling their ancestors over there. They did not do it because they wanted to. They did it first because of force, and secondly, perhaps because of the perks that come with collaborating with the imperialists. The people who are born over there, Uhuru can be any time. And I think it has to do with a lot about understanding themselves. Let me tell you, education is a very positive tool, and it could also be very dangerous in the sense that there's a level of acculturation you have. I've never grown up in society where they tell me you can't play at this time, I can work at 1 a.m. if I'm stopped, except maybe areas that are prone to crime. But over there, people live in the daily consciousness of harassment, of questioning, maybe stray bullet or something that maybe a trigger-happy policeman. So I have to say here that it is high time for them to really forget all those thoughts about maybe the ancestors collaborated and sold them, and learn new ways of discovering their true independent identities.
All right, all right. It's getting more interesting. I want to turn to Jude now. And Jude, looking at this this issue, we talked about those who have been compromised amongst the ranks of Africans who actually have come to, find their place and are content with where they are based on, yes, the benefits that they derive from this. But we know the long-term implication of this. But you have been a victim of racial discrimination. And you've seen a fellow brother, back down when he should have stood up. Do you want to share that with us? And so we can move from there and say, look, okay, how do we resolve this this whole problem?
Yeah, thank you for that. By the virtue that I live there, as you said, I am of the you cannot absorb yourself of discrimination that is systemic. Back there in the system has been built. And not only is it against, we come from Africa, it's also supposed to separate us from each other even when we arrive. So there's that unspoken divide between we who come, the recent immigrants, and they who have been there, who have been in this servitude and this system for a long time. So we're talking about the Black Americans, obviously, which is the African Americans, and then we're talking about the Caribbeans who came earlier than we did. So the, how will I put it? There is a sense of entitlement. So first, the African American or the African Canadian believes that we were the slaves or the descendants of the slaves. We built this system. Then the Caribbeans come and they say, we came and we built the railway. So we developed the system to a level. And then we come, the immigrants from Africa and thereabouts, and they say, you have just come to benefit from all that we have built. So you are a leech. So there's first that rancor that's amongst these, we are all of the same hue, but we still see ourselves from different perspectives. That being said, when the what did he call it? Is this
Salmon.
Okay, when they come and they behold us, they first and foremost behold us as one because of the homogeneity of our color. And because they do, whatever backlash that is coming or whatever systemic racism that exists affects all of us all. For me, I've been there for 20 years thereabouts, so my encounters with racism are manifold. I am writing a book compiling a collection of stories which exemplify 10 of those experiences called How to Be Human and Not a Color. I have a story there where I share about me. It was during the Toronto Film Festival, and I was there, and some Nigerians had come over. They were not for the festival, to do some other stuff for the government, and they needed someone who knew the ground, and of course I was there, so I helped them out. But they wanted to shop. Long story short, I offered to go and help them shop because they were running short of time. Twice I went. The second time was where most of the problem happened, where I went and had bought all this stuff, and these Nigerians were buying $3,000 shoes and all of that. But they're government workers and bank workers and all of that. But I wasn't questioning wherever they got their money from. I was just helping them. They had given me the cash. I put in my account so I could use my card and all. Long story cut short, the security, because usually these huge stores, they have people they call loss prevention officers. You don't see them, but they see you because of the camera. A Jamaican guy or a Jamaican immigrant, a Jamaican immigrant. He comes to me, he was the head of the security, and he said to me, I have to search you. I was the only Black person shopping in the store at that point, particular point in time. There were other white people who were leaving and coming in. Nobody stopped them, but he stopped me. Earlier before that, I was talking to a Black lady who was behind the counter selling, and I developed some rapport with her based on the fact that I'd come there before. Well, he takes me into this, he was trying to get me to go into the security office, and I told him that if you want to search me, you have to search me in the open. But I knew that because of the amount of money involved, and how sudden I had come in possession of that money, there was going to be a problem, because that society is a society that works on laws. Mm. The first question would be, how did you get $50,000? How? I couldn't stand up for that. Well, I was hoping that if the Nigerian government guy who had come and given me the money, he said he was going to join me at the store. If he comes, he'll be able to vouch for how the money came into my possession. I'm there outside. I refused to come into the store because I was leaving when they stopped me. I refused to come to the store. I said, search me here if you have to set me. In my mind, I'm hoping the guy will come and stand up, tell me. And then the guy comes, he sees me, he sees the security, he reads the situation, me with the bag, the security checking the bags, and he just does an about face and he walks away. So here I am stuck. I am with the bags, I'm with the security, he has walked away. How did I come in possession of this monies? I couldn't vouch for. So I was led into the security's office, where the most dehumanizing things happened to me. But the first thing I want to draw from this is people don't understand about slavery and bigotry and all of that. There is a paralyzing, I couldn't understand that until it happened to me. Because I always used to ask myself, why didn't Black people do this? Why didn't they do this? Why did they just allow themselves? And there is something that happens to you, I cannot explain it. It paralyzes you. When you know you are in a situation where you have no out, where there is nothing to rescue you, your fight goes, you just become pliant. You become like a putty, like mud that they can mold. And this man, they brought the black girl, who I said earlier was behind the counter, and they said there was a collaboration between me and her, and there used to be shoplifters who used to come to the store to rob, and I'm part of the syndicate, and how did I get the money, and all of that. And I can't say everything that happened on air, but I was sent to this bottomless pit where I couldn't even see myself as in Jude, as existing as a separate and complete identity. I just saw myself as a receptacle of oppression, as a victim of abuse. And there is a paralyzing thing that happens to that. And it made me understand what has happened to the Black African-American and the African-Canadian. As a heritage, their phobias had the same thing that happened to me that day, happened to them over and over and over and over again. So they have found themselves in this place where there is a paralysis of thought, a paralysis of action, an acceptance of description, a surmountation of even, that means you have even taken the oppression upon yourself to even oppress as a way of belonging, as a way of conforming to the society that is. So I would say that one of the experiences I've had will be that, even though they are manifold others.
All right, all right. The discussion, it's quite interesting, but we want to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be open to phone lines and have our viewers join in the discussion. Don't go away as we discuss the issue of race, class, and ethnicity in Africa. Join us again after the break.
From Lagos
to Tokyo, from Dakar to Moscow,
we have all the world covered for you, no matter where you are.
Lover Plus News is at the heart of it all.
The prayers of many saints will be answered this time.
Bring you our perspective of stories behind the story.
So, and the Bible shows us how hyperinflation will set in. Jesus said, pray that you be counted worthy to escape all these things.
Join us, join us.
Join us on this station.
I release. Our march to freedom is irreversible. We must not allow fear to stand in our way. I have fought against white domination.
No, we are not satisfied, and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream.
Great to have you back on the agenda. I've been discussing race, class, and ethnicity, and having two wonderful guests with me, Jude Idada, literary prize winner, 2019 LNG prize for literary work, and I have here with me Adini Ikunu,
thank you very
journalist
much.
And African affairs analyst. We've been talking a lot about the issue of race and ethnicity, how it affects us as Africans, both at home and abroad. And yes, Jude has painted a very interesting picture, a gloomy one at that, what Africans face outside the shores of Africa. An experience that can only be imagined, a powerlessness, you know, a situation of, you know, submission that, you know, that the situation brings every African to abroad. But the downside to this is that it should point us back home and say, look, I can get, when I'm back at home, I don't have these fears of this consciousness of crossing the line, of being watched, antagonized, of, you know, feeling like a second-class citizen. And then, but another bad part to this is that when, you know, the Salmons come over to Africa.
Yes, please.
They are not accorded the same treatment that Africans get when they're, you know, when they're being hosted by these so-called Salmons, as you put it. They have the best treatment, sometimes even better than we ourselves, because in African culture, the orientation is that we are good hosts, you know, of our guests,
yeah.
And we extend that without any reserve.
Yeah, let me tell you this. The reason we are receptive to see them as superior is part of the dishevelling of the African psyche from the colonial days. And don't forget that there are ways where you have a national identity of pseudo-inferiority by how you treat people. And there are institutionalized support for those people. I could hold, for instance, a PhD or a master's in a particular discipline and maybe get paid maybe $500,000 for a job every month in Nigerian Naira. You employ somebody that has a first degree who is a Salmon, who perhaps was called in because of certain perspective, and the person maybe in 2 weeks takes home what I take in a month in hard currency, and you pay for certain luxuries as well. That means over the years, we have also deliberately created institutions that keep our own under while we give them that superior place. Excuse me, Jude is a global citizen by virtue of what he has done. Mm. And I can say very well that there are certain things that he has churned out in terms of his works that are superior. But what nature has done against him, has created by Salmons, is that his skin is shades darker than theirs. So I think that one of the things we must rework in this country is Africa has actually produced and still producing champions and leaders of knowledge in all walks of life in the 21st century. Can we revamp certain institutional defaults, certain institutional errors, and begin to place our own as those who are superior to them? Let me tell you, there are about 100 mining companies on the stock exchange of Britain. Their mining companies are in South Africa, and these mining companies are located where you have impoverished people. Now, there is a South African president, Cyril Ramaphosa, who is dark-skinned as myself, but there's a Ramaphosa whose economic ideology continues to supplant those ideologies of the people that actually are the original owners of the land. So I think African leaders, in being sincere with themselves, there's a particular paper that I actually put together to the University of Texas at Austin. It is called it talks about the hypocrisy of African leader and the unintelligence of globalization. Globalization is a system that wants to further keep Africa under. And I need to say this, until African leaders themselves understand the deconfiguration and the current configuration, we will not have a reconfigured entity that will favor us. And the reason I've simply said this is this.
Can you say that again?
If we have been deconfigured,
yeah,
to operate in this current configuration, and until Africa realizes that it needs to be reconfigured, we'll continue to have this shameless status quo. If you look at Nigeria, for instance, the so-called Hausa Fulani hegemony that happens to be the supposed leading political power holders among us in this country
If you do a proper dissection, the Fulanis were never from here. From the geographical space called Nigeria, or even in neighboring states, the Fulanis didn't have an ancestral home here. If you call the Kanuri, I'll tell you yes. Because we initially had 7 original Hausa states. Of course, the Bronu were part of it. Katsina, Zamfara, Kanu, and some others. Nupe, for instance, called the Niger, that's Nupe Kingdom. So when the British people came, I'm talking about the divides that they have allowed. Of course, the Quranic education was brought to the northern part of Nigeria and has spread to certain other parts from the north. There was a war in 1804. It was that war that served as the defining moment where, when the Britain came, they met a system on ground. So they felt, okay, if these people were like this, let's just keep them the leadership. So the minority Fulani were empowered to collaborate with the Hausas that quickly accepted Islam. In fact, when the conquerors came to Bronu, they told them, we already know Islam. The same way the Senegalese had experienced the Sufi Islam long ago before the French colonialists came to their shores. So I'm saying there that that's how the West continued to support those who could be divided and ruled over. And they brought the same system to the West, exposing the Southwest or the West of this country or the South to their education. So the more you accepted their education in this part, the more they become receptive to giving you or supporting your leadership position. So you find out that they divided the country along language and ethnic lines so they could bear rule. So the people who had that privileged exposure became those who were favored, became those who were economically empowered, and it disrupted the native intelligence that have functioned for us over the years. I wouldn't say that colonial experience is totally something negative, but a situation where you have substituted people's capacity to think for themselves and to feel inferior, that is why they come here and they ride roughshod. For instance, the Chinese people in this country, for instance, they don't understand. As I speak with you, I keep saying it. There are land disputes in Agbara Ogun State, in Jigawa, in Kano, because the Chinese people displaced farmers who were original owners of the land, and they used the police force of this country. Exactly. That's part of inferior mentality and the support of state institutions, because most of these land grabbings were done in connivance with Nigerian security forces who are not protecting the people of the land.
Okay, so you've pointed out the same challenge that we have, where we have, you know, the insider, you know, scenario. Those amongst our ranks who have actually, you know, aided and abetted this inhuman issue and acts that, you know, has been meted to Africans. But turning to Jude, are you there? Okay, I think we've lost. Okay, Jude is here. So Jude, the question the average, you know, African might ask: oh, you complaining about, you know, one thing of victimization in the Salmon's land, but why don't you come back home? If it's that bad, come back home. You know, but we hear other people responding to that, say, look, I'd rather be here, you know, enjoy, you know, the benefits, you know, a working system, you know, every day, and there's water, there's light, than to come back to Nigeria and, you know, and meet another level of brutality, you know, meted to me. How does that, does that help the situation?
Well, in answering that, it's very, very interesting. For me, I had to leave Nigeria to discover Nigeria. I had to live in the foreign land to fall in love with Nigeria. Because while I was here, I was like every other person, always complaining, always seeing the negatives and all of that. When I went abroad and I started living amongst the foreigners, as it were, and seeing their system and understanding their history and their story, I began to see Nigeria and Africa differently. I began to see what my duty or my allegiance or the fidelity of my affection towards it was. I've been here for 6 months now. Last year, I was here for 9 months. The year before, I was here for 6 months. And gradually, I have come back to always stay and to add value. I have come back to reorientate myself, that I will no longer speak the negative to the country. I will no longer profess the destruction and dismay and always look at it as a glass half full. I will always now start creating that which I want to see by the profession of my tongue. That being said, there's a lot of work to do. There's a lot of stuff I have learned from that country that that are brought here. But first off is the duty of the citizen. What is your duty towards your motherland? What do you owe it? Because even these places were run into, there was a time they were look at the Salmons, as he called it.
Precisely.
Who journeyed from Europe to North America. They went there, they saw this vast land that had challenges of weather, you know, and all of that stuff. But they conquered it. They conquered it through sleight of hand. They conquered it through deception. They conquered it through, dehumanizing programs like slavery and the annihilation.
Oh, no, I think we lost Jude there.
I must take that particular discussion to the next level.
I like his angle.
Yes, his angle is okay.
We have continued to use our mouths to tear down, our nation. Okay, Jude is back.
Exactly.
All right, Jude. You were on a roll there. Let's hear what you were saying once more. Okay, we can't hear you. Okay.
So I realized the strength of who our collective, let's say, our enemy is, and how they've been able to overcome. And I asked myself, why don't we adapt this strength? I used to work in banking and I used to work in telecommunications. When I was in Canada, I stopped my last corporate job. I was vice president of human resources of a company, so I was pretty high, and then I had this Giorgio with one of these huge captains of industry, and he said something to me. He said, there is an economic war that for us to keep our system as it is, that makes people like you want to come, we have to remain on top. It's a pyramid, like the Malthusian pyramid. We have to remain on top. You have to be down so that the best of you, we don't have to come there with our ships to take you as slaves. No, you will come by yourself. You will come by yourself to feed our economy. My younger brother, my sister, my younger brother is a medical doctor. He was trained in UniBed. The education in Nigeria is subsidized when you compare it to the education abroad. He was trained in UniBed. He finished as a medical doctor. What does he do? He leaves and he goes to America. Is now a pediatrician. America did not invest in his education. They did not at all. But they are there benefiting from his education. And who is suffering? Nigeria. In the days of old, that was what they did with slavery. They took the best of us and they took them there. And of course, they bled them to build their economy while we suffered it. So it has happened all over again. And I ask myself, I say, if I am this enlightened, as they call it now, they call it woke. If I'm this woke and I understand what the undercurrent, which is what I spoke about earlier, is the undercurrent of the narrative is that I'm actually contributing to the subjugation of Africa. This Africa that I claim that I love, I'm actually contributing to it. If my human capital is arrested in the West, let me learn from them, just like how they used to come and learn from us and take it back to their people. Let me learn from them and take it back to my people. Let us be a cross-fertilization of ideas of equals. Towards building the African continent, because no one is going to build it for us.
Nobody is going to build it for us.
No matter how we think they will never come and build. But before I go, there's one other thing I want to say. When you see our intelligence, or will I say the intelligentsia, or the height of the corporate world, have you ever realized that they always push people, Africans like us, who have worked in World Bank, who have worked in IMF, they always push them to come and become our finance ministers and lead our countries and everything. These people, I don't know if you can point one of them who came back and their policies actually built or created anything in Africa. No, they are the colonizers we were talking about earlier on, and Kunu was also talking about. These people who come, just like how they came to advise Babangida and all of that for the SAP structural adjustment program and everything, they come to bring Africa down. Because the more Africa is down, the higher they are. The monies, the wealth, as Kunu said. So we are in a competition. A very deep cultural, economic, spiritual, and social competition tries to maintain the status quo of the provider, the oppressor on top, and we, the recipient and the oppressed below. So I choose to fight for the receiver and the oppressed.
Thank you. Wow. And I believe you rest your case there, Jude. Thank you so much. And it's been great having you on the show. As we wind down right now and time is far spent, I want to thank you for staying with us. Quite very insightful, everything you've said so far. We've been talking there with Jude Idada, screenwriter, actor, poet, playwright, producer, best known for his writing, the multi-award feature film, The Tenant. And he's also an LNG Prize for Literature winner. Thank you so much for 2019, precisely. And Ani,
yes,
and well, your final salvo as we wind up, as we close the show.
If anybody finds himself or herself drowning, it's either you slap the water and try to swim to safety, or you shout for help so that somebody who is near the bank and a better swimmer can come. Oftentimes, solutions to the problem, the same way I started, can be found or could be found within. It therefore behooves all of us who foolishly, oftentimes, and sheepishly, more often than not, okay, do the biddings of those who don't mean well for this country,
right,
to begin to dissociate from all of those things we often see as the pottage that would make us lose our birthright.
The pottage that will make us lose our birthright. Well, I need not say any more. And all I can say is thank you for staying with us on another edition of The Agenda. And yes, you can watch us on the go at www.loveworldplus.tv or download our app from any of the online stores. It's Love World Plus. My name is Henry Williams. Until we come your way again, remember that only Africans can build Africa. I'll leave you with this soundbite, if I may, a UN chief urging countries to confront the legacy of slavery. Bye-bye.
Behind today's racial violence, systemic racism, and discriminatory policing lies the failure to acknowledge and confront the legacy of the slave trade and colonialism. To build a more solid foundation for equality, we need to better understand the scope of systemic discrimination with disaggregated data by ethnicity or race. Because when I met the group of experts of Afro descent, they will say in many countries they don't count us. And if they don't count us, we don't count. We also need to make amends for centuries of violence and discrimination, including through formal apologies, truth-telling processes, and reparation in various forms.
Issue on the African scene, the politics of succession in Africa, the crisis of stability and power. How critical is this?
Police arrested 4 people for the violence in Johannesburg, while 8 others were arrested.